गुड मॉर्निंग एंड अस्सलाम वालेकुम टू ऑल माई डियर स्टूडेंट्स हु आर लिसनिंग टू मी। आई होप दैट यू ऑल आर वेल एंड फाइन। वेलकम बैक टू द क्लास ऑफ सोशल स्टडीज। सो एवरी वन, आर यू रेडी? लेट्स स्टार्ट अवर टुडेज लेक्चर। स्टूडेंट्स, लेट्स स्टार्ट अवर टुडेज लेक्चर विद अ होली वर्स। That was the very first verse revealed on Muhammad, peace be upon him, which was Iqra, that means pad, read, right? Iqra bismi rabbikal ladhi khalaq, read in the name of your Lord who has created all that exist. So students, let's begin today's lecture. Although it is not needed, but let me introduce myself. This is Ms. Zuneira, your social studies teacher, and this is your social studies class. It is going to be our 15th lecture, right? So let's see what chapter we started. We started our chapter Muslim rule in South Asia. Okay, we started the chapter Muslim rule in South Asia. As I told you several of the times that your book includes many of the chapters regarding South Asia. So here comes another chapter in front of you, which is Muslim rule in South Asia. Here we are going to see the Muslim rulers who ruled over South Asia. Okay, keeping in mind that South Asia is a region of Asia continent which includes 7 countries. Okay, so let's start our lecture. Okay students, many of the things we had learned from this chapter, and today we are going to continue from where we left in our last class. But before that, let's have a quick review on everything that we have learned. So we started learning about Muhammad bin Qasim. Muhammad bin Qasim was an Arab general who was only 17 years old when he conquered the Sindh. Okay, he was only 17 years old when he conquered the Sindh, and he was an Arab general. After Muhammad bin Qasim, we had learned about Mahmud of Ghazna. Mahmud of Ghazna was the ruler of Afghanistan, and he invaded India 17 times in his life. How many times? 17 times. He invaded India 17 times, and when he invaded 16th time, he destroyed the temple of Somnath as well. He destroyed the temple of Somnath as well. Okay, so Mahmud of Ghazna, who ruled over Afghanistan from 1080 to 1030 AD, it means 30 years he ruled over Afghanistan. Okay, and he was one of the strongest ruler who came to power after the Arab Empire broke up. He ruled over Afghanistan and invaded India 17 times, and during his 16th invasion in 1026 AD, he destroyed the temple of Somnath near present-day Mumbai. Then we had learnt about the Delhi Sultanate. In Delhi Sultanate, we had seen that there used to be many dynasties. The Slave Dynasty, the Khalji Dynasty, the Mughal, the Tughlaq Dynasty, the Sayyid, and the Lodi's Dynasties. Okay, and we had seen the different rulers, different Muslim rulers in different dynasties, and we have to remember their names. Okay, then we started learning about Mughals. Okay, we know that there used to be 7 Mughals who ruled over South Asia. The first Mughal was Babur, and there used to be 6 great Mughals. Okay, total Mughals are 7, but if we say the great Mughals, so 6 Mughal emperors are included in Great Mughals. So the last Great Mughal was Aurangzeb, and the last Mughal was Bahadur Shah Zafar. Bahadur Shah Zafar was defeated by British. Okay, so here in front of you, you can see the later Mughals. The Mughal emperors who came after Aurangzeb were often weak rulers. Okay, Marathas provinces became independent, and Marathas also started invading Delhi. Right? So, as we had learned that the Mughal emperors who came after Aurangzeb were often weak rulers. Provinces became independent and Marathas also started invading Delhi. Foreign invaders such as Nader Shah of Iran and Ahmad Shah Abdali of Afghanistan. Okay, we have to remember these two names, Nader Shah of Iran and Ahmad Shah Abdali of Afghanistan, and plus the British traders. They all grabbed the pieces of Mughal Empire. Okay, they all grabbed the pieces where Mughal's emperor used to rule. And the weakness of these Mughals forced them to accept the British control over South Asia in 1803 AD. However, Mughals continued to be called emperors until the last Mughal emperor, Bahadur Shah Zafar, who became involved in the War of Independence against the British. Okay, and as a result, he was sent away to Rangoon as a prisoner. With his imprisonment, the Mughal Empire also came to an end. Why it came to an end? Because of the weakness of Mughal rulers. Again, it comes in front of you. Weaknesses forced the Mughal Emperor Bahadur Shah Zafar to accept British to control over South Asia in 1803 AD. Bahadur Shah Zafar became involved in the War of Independence against the British. As a result, they sent him to Rangoon as a prisoner. Okay. The last topic of your chapter is Sufism. Sufism was an approach to Islam. As I have highlighted here, it's an approach to Islam that developed around 8th century. It developed around 8th century AD. Sufis used to believe in love and peace. They did not participate in wars and stayed away from the courts of the kings. So, what is Sufism? Sufism was an approach to Islam that developed around 8th century. And Sufis believed in peace and love and thought that the real purpose of religion was to understand God through understanding themselves. They did not participate in wars and stayed away from the courts of the king. Okay, if a king wished to meet Sufi, he would have to go to the Sufi's cottage. Right? Sufis became very popular among the people of all religions in South Asia, and many non-Muslims converted to Islam through their influence and teachings. Right? So, as I told you that Sufis became very popular among the people of all religions in South Asia, and many non-Muslims converted to Islam through saints of South Asia. Okay, and we have many names of Sufis as the famous Sufi saints of South Asia. So let's review their names. The saints of South Asia are Data Ganj Baksh, Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti, Qutbuddin Bakhtiar Kaki, Baba Farid Shakarganj, Nizamuddin Aulia. They are the Sufi saints of South Asia. Okay, and they had a good approach to Islam. They believed in peace and love. They thought that the real purpose of life is to understand God through understanding yourself. And these are the saints who did not participate in any war, and they stayed away from the courts of the king. If any king wanted to meet them, the king had to go to these Sufi saints. Okay, they did not used to go. Here comes the name of the regional poets in front of you. Many of the poets of the regional languages of South Asia were also great Sufis, and they include Bulle Shah, Rehman Baba, Shah Abdul Latif Bhittai, and Amir Khusro. The great poet, they all were the great poet plus Sufis, right? Here you can see the shrines of different Sufi saints who believed in peace and love and who had good approach to Islam. And it is in front of you. You can observe here the shrines or the tombs of Sufi saints, okay, of South Asia. Okay, students, here come some of the questions in front of you, and you have to answer me these questions one by one. Okay, so these are the answer: when did Aurangzeb die? Who were the foreign invaders? When did British control over South Asia? Who did became the part of War of Independence? Name three Sufi saints of South Asia. So, students, mashallah, everybody has answered me very properly. Now it's time to say goodbye to all of you. Take care yourself. Inshallah, we shall meet in the next class. Take care and have a good day. Bye.